The Alex Belfield In Conversation Podcast with daisymedia.co.uk.
Hi, this is Dara O'Brien. You're listening to one of the nation's finest. Oh, it's not Terry Wogan, I'll give you that, but he's up there. Nah, he's not even up there.
Alex Belfield.
I'm thrilled to welcome the delicious Gail Porter. How are you?
Oh, I've never been called delicious before. Wow, that's a real compliment.
Listen, I've just read this new book. I haven't got quite to the end, but my God, what a life.
Yeah, it's, you know, someone said to me before, would you fancy writing a book? I think they ask all people to write books these days, don't they? And I said, no, not interesting at all. I'm not interested in writing a book. Why would anyone read anything about me? And then my hair fell out and I thought, hey, we've got a bit of a story going here. And I just thought, well, it was more sort of self-help for me to write down about a few issues and problems. And if it's going to be any help to anybody, that would be quite, it would make me feel very good indeed. But it's mostly about sort of losing my, well, it's about lots of things from, you know, being a young TV presenter to being a bald 36-year-old mother of one.
Let's start right at the beginning. What were you like as a child? Were you wanting to be showbiz? Did you want this life that you've now got?
I just wanted to be, from 1978, I wanted to be Princess Leia. That was all. I loved Star Wars.
Well, don't we all?
Oh, I just loved it. And I was just obsessed with Star Wars, and I used to have the big badges, you know, those huge badges that you could get from the Odeon in the old days when you come out and you buy the badges and you get the pencil cases, and oh, I was so excited. And then I got my mum to put my hair like Princess Leia's with those two buns on the side of your head, and people at school used to call me snobby because I was always that kid that had their hands up going, oh, I know, miss, I know. And so when I turned up with my hair in those sort of bun things, you know, I might as well just say, go on, punch me, because I'm an idiot. So yeah, I wasn't really very aware of what anyone thought of me. I didn't really care, to tell you the truth. They could call me whatever they liked. I was just always in my own sort of dreamy world of Star Wars and waiting for Luke Skywalker to give me a phone because I was sure it was going to happen at one point. Of course, you know, so I was kind of a bit of a dreamy kid.
What was the first step getting you on the ladder to being known by virtually everybody in the country?
Oh, it's just such a strange story. I don't know. I was just an average kid, you know, did good at school, studied hard, did a bit of drama school, and you know, I was encouraged by music teachers to do a bit of singing and dancing, but I never went to proper drama school. It was kind of, you know, after school clubs. And then I went to college and studied film and photography because I knew I wanted to be involved in television somehow, but I wasn't entirely sure which way. And then I became a runner, which, if anyone doesn't know what a runner is, it's basically a dog's body working for a television company. And so I did that for a very long time, doing things like cleaning railings with a toothbrush and making people cups of tea, but you had to stir the, you know, once you put the sugar in, the only one wanted it stirred to the left. I'm not naming any names, but it was all very strange indeed, and working huge amounts of hours for no money. And then I sort of worked my way up, did production managing.
How many people did you have to sleep with to actually get your first proper job?
I never slept with anyone, amazingly enough. I was actually quite prudish, Alex. I was quite, you know, I was a late starter in life. Everything was a bit, you know, I wasn't very good at these things. And I was a bit shy. Well, I wasn't shy, but I just, you know, oh, I don't want to go into that bit.
Well, you want to see my list to be sat here today. Sue Pollard, Jay McDonald, I've done them all. I mean.
Oh, bless you. You deserve everything you've got. But, no, I didn't actually do anything naughty. And yeah, it's just someone suggested I went for an audition for a kids' programme, and I went for the audition. Unfortunately, the script hadn't turned up, so I kind of turned up empty-handed with no idea, and everyone was very well versed in what they were doing, and they'd memorised their scripts, and I was kind of, hiya, I'll just make things up as I went along, and I got the job. So, first audition, got the job, and I kind of just sort of moved around in children's television circles. And it was, I think, having the background in production was such a great help because you respect everyone you work with, you know. And presenting's not, it's a tough job for some people, but, you know, I didn't find it that tough. And I don't think a lot of people find it that tough. But because I was so aware of what went on in the background, that I wasn't so aware of myself in front of the camera. It was just kind of, it was a team effort. And I think that always helps.
All right, so we've done a brief summary of how you become to be Mrs. Show Business.
Yeah.
This is where I start getting a problem, because I don't like whingy celebs who go, woe is me, I'm on £10 million and the Britney Spears and all of that. How difficult is it to cope with fame? Because I've interviewed so many stars who have said that, oh, well, you can either make it a big deal or you can just deal with it. How did you find it?
I don't find fame a problem in the slightest. That's not been my issue at all. I had a mental health issue, and the reason I touched upon it in the book is because a lot of people do have mental health issues, and a lot of people are embarrassed to talk about it, and I was embarrassed to talk about it.
I think it was such a shock for us all finding out that, because your public persona is so bubbly and you're so charismatic, to find out that there was this bipolar issue going on and the depression, we just couldn't believe it.
No, well, my friends know me so well that, you know, they'd know if I'd just disappeared for 2 days, they'd think something's up, and I'd pretend that maybe I'd gone somewhere, but I'd just hide in the house and shut the curtains and find it quite difficult. I don't know where it came from, and I'm just pleased now that I actually admitted to someone and I got help, and someone said, it's okay, you're not crazy, we can sort this out, and touch wood, it's been completely sorted, and I'm absolutely back on track 150%. So that's why I thought I'd write about it, because there is light at the end of the tunnel, but you just got to admit to yourself, okay, I've got a problem here and I'm not dealing with it very well, so I'm going to have to get some help. So I think that's the hardest thing for people to do, and it is embarrassing. Well, I found it extremely embarrassing, because as you say, I've got a great job and I've got everything going for me, and for some reason this dark cloud was just looming around in my brain. So luckily we've shifted it.
Just want to go back to the 90s and that FHM thing you did on the Houses of Parliament.
Yes.
What is it like to be adored? No, seriously. No, Gail, honestly, truly, I'm deeply unattractive. I have never been adored, and I've always wanted to be, just for one day, to be you in that picture. I mean, for a while, you were the most stunning thing in Britain that everybody wanted to date.
No, because I wasn't. Do you know what? I did magazines. I'm a short bird from Edinburgh. You'd walk past me in the street and you wouldn't look twice, but because, you know, they gave you the makeup, the hair, you know, they did it all for you. They did a bit of airbrushing and they did a ridiculous stunt without telling me and put me on the House of Parliament. You're going to get controversy and you're going to get people thinking you're pretty or whatever it is. But believe me, Alex, you walk past me in the street, you probably wouldn't know. No. You'd probably go, hey, stop it.
Sorry, you missed what I said. Sorry, you missed what I said. What I said was every guy in the country wanted to date you. I don't care what you say about what you look like without the makeup. They did. And I think one of the reasons they really liked you, probably more than the Jordans now, is because you did look real and you did look gettable even.
Yeah, well, I think I still am gettable if anyone's looking.
Now, what number do I have to dial to make that happen?
I'll tell you afterwards. Do you want to do it on air just in case, you know?
Seriously, though, how do you cope with that kind of adoration and that kind of loving? I mean, that must be a peculiar sensation that most people don't get.
Yeah, it's a very weird thing. And, you know, even now when I go out, I sometimes DJ at my friend's club circus, and you know, lots of people give you cuddles, and it's really, I don't know, I'm a really tactile person. I really enjoyed it. I enjoyed the attention. Maybe that's a terrible thing to say, but I quite enjoyed it. And everyone was so nice. Maybe, like you say, because I think they think I'm accessible, you know, and I don't look too false, that, you know, I like people coming up and chatting to me in the street because I love talking. I don't know if you've noticed, but I love a chat.
I have, really, yeah. To be honest.
I love a chat, and I love, you know, I love the fact that people, especially now with no hair, they'll come up to you and go, well, do you know what? My mum, blah, 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 she lost a bit of her hair. And everyone will talk to me. There's not a day goes past without at least a good two or three people coming up for a wee chat. And it drives, you know, my boyfriend James, it drives him crazy sometimes. But I love it. I could chat all day.
We've talked about the showbiz side. I just want to talk about the thing that has made you so famous recently, which is the loss of hair and the alopecia. Is that officially what it is?
Yeah, I have got alopecia aorta totalis, which means I don't have a single hair on my body, nothing, which is quite incredible.
My uncle died of motor neuron about 2 years ago, and I lost all my hair for a year. It literally went within a week.
Of your uncle dying?
Yes. Nothing happened for a year, and then it came back within a week.
Wow.
And it was the most miserable year of my life. Now, I've got ginger flaming red hair, and it's kind of my...
I love ginger hair.
Oh, I hate it, honestly.
Oh, I love red hair.
You know what they say, Gail? Rusty roof, damn basement. I'm not saying anymore. But the thing is with this ginger hair, of course, it was my calling card. So everywhere I went, in all the different radio stations or when I do my live work, everybody recognised me straight away. And of course, then they didn't. And then you have to explain. And it was just awful. And I didn't go out for an entire year.
Oh, that's terrible.
How do you get the confidence to do it? Because I think as bad as it would be for a bloke, it must be a million times worse for a lady.
Well, I don't think I'm really courageous. I think... you know, it happened so quickly. I had my full head of hair. 4 weeks later, it all fell out. I didn't really have I know it sounds strange to say, but it was almost a blessing in disguise because I didn't have time to think about it. And I had to just say, okay, am I going to wear a wig or am I going to just see this through? And I'm such a fiddler and I'm so clumsy. I thought the wig thing's just not going to work with me. Each to their own. Some people love wigs. And I tried to wear little bandana type things, but I kept taking them off because they were annoying me. And then I thought, well, you know, I've got a good shaped head. I'm very lucky. I've got a nice shaped head. So I thought, we'll just have to see this through, and I hoped that maybe it would just be a couple of months, but it's now been 2.5 years now. So I don't know, I just get on with it now, and people are always smiling to me, and whether they think I'm crazy or whatever, most people are just really nice about it. But like you say, you have to explain it to a lot of people, or people think the worst, that you're going through chemotherapy or something. And I just, you know, I'm not going through anything as awful as that. So I'm really lucky in some way. So I don't know. My daughter thinks it's hilarious. Mm. And I'm the instantly recognisable mother that walks in and they go, honey, it's your mum. Yeah, it's your mum. Hooray. Slap it. You know, but they enjoy it. They think it's funny. And we have a laugh with it. You know, honey will sometimes say, if a little boy or girl walk past, go, she's still quite a hair. And honey will go, she left it on the bus. And so we just, you know, we have a giggle with it. And she doesn't want me to grow my hair back. So as long as she loves me, that's all the love that I really need. But, you know, people have been really kind, and I'm just so used to it now, Alex. I mean, you must have got used to it after a year.
No.
Did you not?
Never.
I don't mind it. I love the fact I get up and I think, oh, I've got 15 minutes till I've got to get the car to go somewhere, and I think, oh, I'll just watch telly till 5 past, then I'll have a shower and get dressed and go.
I know all that, and I really appreciate that, and I pray that you're telling me the truth. But is there not something inside you that is niggling away saying, I just wish it came back? Does it question your femininity? Do you look at yourself in a different way because you know that some others may look at you in a different way? That's what I mean.
I think when it first happened, I felt really unfeminine. And I remember the first time I put a dress on and I burst into tears and I said, I can't go out. I just don't look feminine. And James would say to me, you know, you do, you're still the same. But it was really hard to overcome that. Now, I kind of use it to my advantage. I have fun with it. You know, when I DJ, I pop on like some silver headpiece, or I'll put feathers on my, you know, I'll make a feather boa thing type and put it on my head. And I do actually feel quite, honey, because honey thinks it's really cool, I feel quite okay about it now. It's kind of, you know, it's been there for so long, and I just feel more confident within myself. I've learned to like myself a lot more than I did before, and I don't feel like I can hide away anymore. You can't just pop your hair over your face and go, oh, I'm having a bad day. Mm. You just have to get up and go, well, this is it. This is me. And I'm quite enjoying it, to tell you the truth. When we went to a party last week, I got my head painted and the children got their face painted. And they were very, very, they were pleased with me, apart from one of the little girls went to me, I got a ladybird on my head and they thought it was all lovely and cute. And one of the girls went, you should have got a target. I was like, yeah, thanks, you little so-and-so.
Is there any chance it could come back now?
I don't know, you know. I mean, never say never. Like you said, yours came back after a year. My friend Michelle's been bald since she was 5. She got her hair back when she was 18. It fell out again when she was 19, and she's never had it back since.
Well, I really love the book, and Gail Porter's Laid Bare is brilliant. If you're going through a difficult time, I think it would help. Thank you so much for talking to me.
Thanks so much for having me on.
I love you very much.
Oh, I love you too.
The Alex Belfield In Conversation Podcast with daisymedia.co.uk.